So far we have discussed about syntax of predicate logic, and partly we also discussed semantics of predicate logic, where we discuss that a given well-formed formula, it's true with respect to domain, and it depends upon the domain that you have taken into consideration. That is, the same kind of well-formed formula can be true with respect to, suppose let us say you take the natural numbers, it might be true. If you take the other numbers into consideration, integers, etc., the same formula can be false as well. So you can talk about truth value of a given well-formed formula only with respect to a model. A model consists of a domain and an interpretation function I. So what we will be talking today is one important decision procedure method, which we already discussed in the case of propositional logic. So that is the semantic tableaux method. So this method is due to first originated in the works of Hintikka, and then later it was reformulated by Raymond Smullyan, etc. So these are the people who are responsible for this particular kind of method. And using this method, as in the case of propositional logic, we can find out whether a given formula is a valid formula. That means all the tautologies are valid formulas, just as in the case of propositional logic. And you can also talk about when two sentences in a predicate logic are consistent to each other, or when a given formula satisfies within a domain. So we will be talking about this particular kind of method in some greater detail with respect to the predicate logic, and then we will consider some examples so that we can get familiarize ourselves with this particular kind of method. Semantic tableaux method, it consists of some kind of semantic tableaux rules for the propositional logic, and in addition to those rules for the propositional logic, we have four additional rules for dealing with the quantifiers. What is extra in predicate logic is simply the quantifiers. So we have all the connectives, and negation, implies, if and only if, etc. Plus, in addition to that, in our language of predicate logic, we have quantifiers. That is, for all x, and there exists some x. In the case of propositional logic, we know that these are the rules that we used in case of propositional logic. In the case of semantic tableaux for the predicate logic, you have all the rules that are already there in the case of propositional logic. Plus, in addition to that, we have some rules for quantifiers. So there are four such rules. So I will be discussing these four rules in greater detail in a while from now. But before that, so there are something called alpha and beta rules in the context of propositional logic. So we have these connectives, negation, or, and implies, and if and only if. Now, suppose if you have a formula like this thing, not p, and then you simply write it as not p only, and then p and q, so this is written as p and q. So we are constructing a tree diagram for this particular kind of formula. So this looks like a trunk of a tree. So whereas p or q branches out, it will be like the branches of the tree. And the only thing which is which you need to observe here is that this is an upside down kind of tree. A tree will be like this, trunk will be like this, and then branches will be there. But for our convenience, we are taking the upside down kind of tree. So now p or q, the tree structure for this one is this p q, and then we have other kind of connectives, implication. So we have not p or q. So this is the structure for this p implies q, and whatever is left is this one, p if and only if q. So it is like this, both p q are true and not p not q are true. So these rules are based on the semantics of these propositional logic. We know that a conjunction is going to be a formula with the conjunction is going to be true when both the conjuncts are true. That's why it is sitting at the trunk of the tree. If any one of this thing is false, that is going to be false. So now these are considered to be alpha rules. So now beta rules are with respect to the negation of all these things. Suppose if you come across negation of P, you simply substitute it with P, and then negation of P and Q. So negation of conjunction is a disjunction, so it is not P, not Q. And then negation of P or Q, so it is negation of disjunction is a conjunction, so it will be not P, not Q. And then there are three other things which are left, two other things which are left, not of P implies Q. So this is simply P and not Q. And then P if and only if Q, negation of that. So this is going to be P and not Q and P. I can even write it as not PQ and not PQ and not QP. It doesn't matter what way you write it and all. So these are the rules for the propositional logic. So now we need some more rules to deal with the quantifiers. That means the formulas that begin with the quantifiers. We need to have a few more rules that I will be talking about in a while from now. So the tabular method is based on an attempt to construct a counterexample to a given formula. The main idea of this, main idea behind this method is that given a well-formed formula, instead of checking for whether or not it is true and all, what you look for is, you look for a counterexample where that formula is going to be false. So if at least in one instance the formula is going to be false, at least that means you have come up with a counterexample. So in the beginning of this course, we discuss that an argument is considered to be invalid if you have, especially when it is possible for the premises to be true and the conclusion is false. If it is impossible for the premises to be true and the conclusion to be false, then that is called as a valid argument. It is considered to be a valid argument. So in the semantic tableaux method, the main idea is this, that you try to look for a counterexample, because that is going to make it invalid. So the tabula begins with the formula not alpha. Suppose if you are given a formula alpha, which expresses some kind of formula in the predicate logic, then you start with the negation of that formula, and then you start constructing the tree based on the rules which I am going to discuss in a while from now. So the tabula begins with not alpha for some sentence alpha in a language L. So now a counterexample is considered to be another kind of structure A, which means we must specify again the domain D, an interpretation of each constant in that particular kind of language L, and an interpretation of each predicate in that particular kind of language L. Usually once you construct the semantic tableaux tree for a given formula, suppose if you come across, if you negate the formula and then your branch is open, at least some of the branches are open, and that will serve as our counterexample. That means you have come up with an instance where you have true premises and a false conclusion. So from the open branch, you can construct a counterexample, and then you can cook up a domain, and then based on the open branches, you can come up with a structure in which this formula is considered to be invalid. Now suppose these are some of the rules that we will be making use of with respect to quantifiers. Suppose at some point in our consideration, some point in our construction of your tree, that means you are trying to construct a tree for the given predicate logical formula. So we come to an extent where let us say you have a formula, there exists some x, phi x. So there exists some x is an existential quantifier. So this, suppose if you find it on the node of the tabula, so then we want to make this thing true. So we need some element A in our domain D. So some element A has to exist so that it will become an instance of that particular kind of thing, such that phi of A has to be true. So our rule should allow us to introduce phi A on the path, provided that the parameter A has not yet appeared on the path. So now there are four more rules that we will be using with respect to for all x and there exists some x, etc. So these are the four rules that we will be using. So these are all sitting at the background and all alpha and beta rules and all. So similarly with respect to quantifiers, suppose if you come across a formula like this in the given tree and all. So now from this you need some kind of an object A, a parameter in your domain, that means A has to belong to a domain D. So now we should be in a position to say that it is PA. There exists some x, PX is true when obviously one of the instances is also true. So now this is where A is considered to be new. So this rule says that, for example, if you come across two existential quantifiers like this, Q, X, etc. Once you eliminate this quantifier, you use an individual letter A, and then another time, in another occasion, if you remove this existential quantifier, you don't use this parameter A, but you use B, any other thing which is other than this A. So whatever you use just below this one, it should not figure out in your branch earlier. So this is one of the important rules with respect to existential quantifier. So each time you remove this existential quantifier, you have to use a new parameter. That means this A should not exist anywhere else in the tree, the earlier parts of your tree diagram. So now the other rule is this thing, for all x, px, if it has to be true. So this says that for any x that px is going to be true. So now, so you can simply substitute it as pa, you can say for any arbitrary value a. You can freely substitute any value for this particular kind of thing. It is true for A, it is true for B, it is true for C, etc. and all. It is as good as saying that all crows are black. You are saying that a particular crow A is black, another crow which you have taken into consideration B, that is also black, etc. So now these are the alpha rules with respect to the quantifiers. Now the other rule which we have is the beta rule. It talks about the negation of this quantifiers. So now negation of for all x, px. So this is nothing but if you push the negation inside, and negation of universal quantifier will become existential quantifier, and you push the negation inside. Then if you remove this particular kind of thing, then you use the same kind of rules. You cannot simply apply rule for this one and saying that for not for all x px, you cannot simply say that it is not px and all. So this changes to there exists some x, not px, and then you can eliminate this existential quantifier using the same kind of rules. Each time you eliminate the existential quantifier, you have to use a new parameter. So now the other rule is this thing, not for all x, px. Suppose if you come across this particular kind of formula in the tree, in the construction of your tree, you come across this one, then it is nothing but, sorry, this is there exists some x, px. So this changes to for all x, not of px. So these are the rules that we require to construct tree diagrams for any given predicate logical formula. So the only thing which you need to note is that when you are trying to eliminate this existential quantifier, you need to use a new parameter. Each time when you remove this existential quantifier, you need to use a new parameter. So this A, B, C, etc. has to exist in the domain. They are the objects in a given domain. So essentially what we are trying to see is that you are trying to construct a tree diagram based on, we are looking for a counter example by negating the given well-formed formula, and you are constructing a tree based on these particular kinds of rules. So now this is what we have explained already. Suppose at some point, the second rule says that is also considered to be an alpha rule. Suppose at some point in our construction, we come to an universal formula for all x, phi x on the node of the tree, then since for all x px is true, phi x is true, phi of a also has to be true for any element of your domain. So there is never a problem with substitution of any term into this particular kind of thing. Unlike the case of there exists some x px, we have some restriction. Once you use one particular kind of parameter, you are not supposed to use the same thing. When you are eliminating some kind of existential quantifier, in the next time when you come across existential quantifier in your tree. But there is no such kind of restriction in case of universal quantifiers. They are readily available for it is true for all kinds of A's, etc. So we always add the instance phi of A to your branch recursively. I mean, you can n number of times you can use this particular kind of thing. As well as for all x, phi x, again to the path. Whenever you want to use again this thing, you can reintroduce the same formula for all x, phi x again into the path. So now these are some of the truth conditions with respect to quantifiers. It tells us when a quantifier is going to be valuation of a given quantifier is true or false. So valuation of A, there exists some x phi, is going to be true, especially when valuation of A phi A x, that has to be true. That means this the formula phi A has to be true for at least one particular kind of A. If at least one A satisfies this particular kind of thing, then it is called as there exists some x phi. Otherwise it is going to be false. In the same way, for all x phi, this has to be for all x phi, it has to be represented in that way. There is a mistake here. So for all x phi has to be true, especially when the phi A has to be true for any kind of A that you are taking into consideration. So in the second case, for all A it has to, that particular kind of phi A has to be true. In the first case, it has to be true in at least one kind of occasion. So this is the only difference between these existential and universal quantifiers. So these are the quantifier rules which we need it while constructing the semantic tableau trees. For example, if you come across a formula for all x phi x, then you will simply substitute it with phi of t, and phi for all x phi x, where t is considered to be a ground. For example, if you come across not for all x phi x, then you simply substitute it as not phi a, where if you come across there exists some x phi x, you simply substitute it as phi of a, where a is always considered to be a new parameter. In the same way, it is not the case that there exists some x phi, that is simply replaced by not phi. So these are the things which we have explained already. So now one important remark is that we are saying that each time when you are removing the existential quantifier, we are using a new parameter. So what do we mean by saying that A is new? A is new means that this particular kind of A does not occur in the path that is being extended. So suppose if it is used earlier, then you are not supposed to use the same kind of literal A, but you have to use some other kind of thing. It can be A prime or B or some other thing. Just to make a distinction, you are using a different kind of parameter. Or we can insist that A not occur in the tabula that is being extended. So you have to ensure that nowhere else in that particular kind of tree diagram this particular kind of A occurs. Then you can use this particular kind of literal A. So a little bit more about this tableaux of predicate logic. Just we'll look into it quickly. All these things will be very clear once we talk about some kind of examples. So now let us consider some kind of formal analysis of tab blocks for the predicate logic. Let sigma be a set of sentences from L. So a sentence in predicate logic that we have defined earlier, a sentence in predicate logic is the one which doesn't have any free variables. If it is free variables, it is considered to be a formula in the predicate logic. So if suppose gamma is considered to be a set of sentences from in the language of predicate logic, it can be axioms, it can be any other thing and all. And let us consider a finite tabula from that sigma. We have constructed a finite tabula from sigma. It is considered to be a binary tree labeled with a formula L A, which satisfies the following kind of properties, following definition and all. So it goes like this: all one node trees are labeled with a formula or finite tablocks from gamma. Obviously the path ends after path ends in finite steps and all. So now the second thing is that if tau is considered to be finite tabula from sigma, we constructed a kind of tree from sigma, and phi is a path through this tau. That means it is extended in a tree starting with the starting the main formula at the node, and then you have started expanding that particular kind of formula in a tree, and A is on that particular kind of path of the tree. Then the extension placing the components A1 and A2 on that particular kind of path is also considered to be a finite tabula. This tells us that what is considered to be a finite tabula and all. The third thing says that if tau is considered to be a finite tabula from sigma, that means it ends in some finite steps and all, and finite intervals of time. So phi is a path through tau, and B is on that particular kind of path. Then the extension of phi placing the components of B1 on the left hand side of the branch and B2 on the right hand side of the branch is also considered to be finite tabula from sigma. Essentially what we are trying to talk about is that you have some sigma which consists of some basic formulas, etc. and all, which we know that they are all sentences in the predicate logic. And together with that we have a given formula A, we add to that particular kind of thing, and then we are trying to construct a tree. So now we are telling that so when that construction, after constructing the tree, is it going to be a finite tabula or not? So these are some of the things which tells us that this is going to be a finite tabula. It's not going to end forever and ever and all. It will end at some point. So ending means in a sense that once you end up with only atomic kind of prepositions, then you have to close the tree. Or whenever you come across a formula X and its negation, then also you will close the tree. That means the path ends there itself. That is considered to be contradictory path. So now the fourth rule tells us that if tau is considered to be a finite tabula from sigma, that means you constructed a tree from sigma, and phi is a path through tau, and let us say another thing C on that particular kind of path phi, then the extension placing the component C1 and C on phi is also considered to be finite tablocks from sigma. This rule tells us that only we are just trying to construct a finite tabula based on you given any formula, we have only finite kind of tabula, because it the tabula ends after once you have an atomic formula at the end of the somewhere else in the branches, tabula will end there itself. So there is no way in which you can extend the tree. So all the tablas end with atomic prepositions. So now tablocks for predicate logic, if tau is considered to be a finite tabula and phi is considered to be path through tau and D on phi, then the extension placing the component D1 on phi is also considered to be finite tablocks. In the same way, if tau is considered to be finite tablocks from sigma and phi is a sentence from sigma, then the extension of phi where phi is placed on each path of each path phi through particular kind of formula tau is also considered to be finite tablocks from sigma. So like this if tau 0, tau 1, tau n, etc. is a sequence of finite tablogs from sigma such that for each n greater than 0, tau of n plus 1, the next one, is constructed from tau n by the application of all these rules which we have mentioned so far. So then tau is considered to be, tau is equivalent to union of n tau, that is also considered to be tabular from sigma, is also considered to be a finite tabular. So we have not said anything great about this thing except that tabular ends in finite steps. So for any given formula we have a finite tabular. So now there are certain things which you can talk about with respect to this tabular constructions. So let us consider that tau be a tabular. That means you have constructed a tree diagram for a given formula, and phi is a path through tau. That means sometimes it will have branches, sometimes it might be only trunk and all, and etc. and all, depending upon the formula that you are taking into consideration. So now the path phi is considered to be contradictory if for some sentence phi, any sentence that you are taking into consideration phi, both phi and not phi appears in the same path of your tree. Phi and psi not phi occurs in the same branch, then it will close. So then the path is considered to be contradictory path. So phi tau is considered to be contradictory if every path on tau is considered to be contradictory. So whenever suppose if you have a branch and then you have two paths in particular, one is going to the left hand side and the right hand side, in both the paths you come across a literal and its negation, then obviously that is contradictory, and then entire path is considered to be contradictory. So if tau is considered to be proof of alpha from sigma, and tau is a contradictory tabular from sigma with its root node labeled not alpha, if there is a proof tau of alpha from sigma, we say that it is considered to be alpha provable from sigma, and it is denoted by alpha is proved from sigma. And the other way of saying, I mean, when do we say that sigma is considered to be inconsistent? If there is a proof of a contradiction from sigma, that means you come across A and not A in a given branch. So we can also use tablogs to show that alpha is true in sigma. So whenever sigma is true, alpha also has to be true. In that sense, alpha is a logical consequence of sigma. That means what essentially we are trying to do is that given sigma, we are adding not alpha to it, and then we are trying to see when the branch closes or not. When the branch closes, then not of alpha is considered to be a contradiction, then obviously alpha has to be true. That means you cannot deny the formula and all, because denial of the formula leads to the contradiction. So what essentially we are trying to do is we are adding not alpha to sigma, and then we are trying to show that it is unsatisfiable. So if all the branches closes and all, if it becomes unsatisfiable, then the formula is going to be, original formula is going to be valid. Otherwise it's going to be invalid, because at least there will be one particular kind of counter example. So now this is the thing which we will make use of in constructing proofs of some kind of formulas and all. So now let us consider some examples so that we can consider, we can understand this particular kind of method in a better way. So let us try to say that you take some formulas into consideration, and then we will see whether this is considered to be provable in the predicate logic or not. So for all x, Px implies Pa. So now this is the formula which is given to us. Is the formula in the predicate logic. So in the semantic tablogs method, what one essentially does is that you take the negation of the formula and show that this is considered to be unsatisfiable. If negation of x is unsatisfiable, that means all the branches closes, then that implies x is considered to be a valid formula. Valid formula or tautology or something like that. So that is what essentially we are trying to do. So now we negate the formula, and then we need to use this alpha and beta rules that we have mentioned here. So, so this is in this format x and y. So this can be like this for all x px and not pa. So how did you get this to this one? Not of p implies q is simply p and not q. Somewhere else we have used this particular kind of rule. Negation of p implies q is p and not q. So now, so what is what essentially we are trying to say is that whether this is provable in your whether it is considered to be valid formula or not. That's what we are trying to check. So now you have something called for all x px at the node of somewhere else in this kind of formula. Whenever you come across this particular kind of formula, for all x px means it instance is also true. That means it has to be true for a formula A also. A has to be having this particular kind of property P. Suppose if you say all are happy or something like that, and but if you take a particular kind of individual, that individual also has to be happy, has to feel happy. So that means for all x px means one instance of that one is pa. So now you come across pa and not pa in the path of this particular kind of tree. So this particular kind of thing closes now because it is a contradiction. Not pa and pa leads to contradiction. So that means what essentially we have shown is simply this, that not of x is unsatisfiable, because if you take the negation of this particular kind of given formula, it leads to the closure of branches. That means it is unsatisfiable. Satisfiable. That means x has to be a valid kind of formula. So that means we have derived this particular kind of thing. For all x px implies pa is a theorem in your in the language of predicate logic. So let us consider some more examples so that for example, if you say this particular kind of, this is a famous example that we have been trying to talk about right from the beginning of this course, that is this thing, all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, so Socrates is mortal. This is a famous example which is given in all the introductory logic courses and all. So now you represent it as H, humans, and then this as mortal as M, because if you represent it with the same letter M, there will be no distinction between these two predicates. So now the first sentence will become like this. If X is man, of course we are representing it as H as man. If X is a human being, then X has to be mortal. Now Socrates is mortal, that means M. Socrates is a man, means this is HX. This has to be written with the individual letter S. Let us say S stands for Socrates. This represents some kind of specific kind of objects in the domain. So what is our domain? Domain consists of people or human beings, etc. So you don't have to take into consideration animals, trees, plants, etc. into that one. That is not in this particular kind of domain. So now this is HS, and then Socrates is mortal. So now this is considered to be this thing. This predicates are written in the capital letters, whereas the individual constants that you come across in this particular kind of formula are written in terms of small letters. So now this is the argument that we have. So now we want to see whether this particular kind of argument is valid or invalid. We know that this is a valid argument. So now we are trying to establish it with the help of the predicate logic. So what essentially we are doing in the second part of this lecture is that we are trying to consider some examples like this, and then we are trying to see, we are trying to make use of the semantic tableaux method, which serves as some kind of decision procedure method. It tells us when, how the, if the argument is valid, it tells us, it gives us some kind of a proof for this particular kind of thing, that this conclusion follows from this premises and all. So now let us take this argument in detail. Hx implies mx, and second is this thing h and s, and this is going to be your conclusion m and s. So in the semantic tableaux method, what you will do is we'll start with the negation of the conclusion. So what essentially we are trying to do is sigma is this particular kind of thing. So these two premises constitute sigma. So now what you are doing is you are adding not alpha to it, because where alpha is considered to be the conclusion. So now if sigma union not alpha is unsatisfiable, then so how did we come to this unsatisfiability? We landed into this particular kind of problem, especially when you are taking the negation of the conclusion. That means negation of alpha is unsatisfiable. That means alpha has to be valid. That means alpha has to be true. So now you take the negation of the conclusion like this, and then you try to construct a tree for this one. So these are all atomic formulas and all, you don't have to worry much about it. So now hx implies mx happens for all x and all. So that means this has to be true for even this particular kind of thing. For all human beings, if x is a human being, then x has to be mortal. That means all human beings have to die someday or other. So that happens even for the Socrates, or even for anything which you substitute it into this one. If at all he is a human being, then it has to die. So now this S stands for Socrates. So one instance of this one is this. So we have used this particular kind of rule. For all x, px, if you come across this particular kind of formula in your tree, then you can simply replace it as A. This happens for any A. So now Hs implies Ms is a thing which we have thing. This is called a universal instantiation of this one. One instance of this one is this. Now this can be represented as not Hs and Ms. So this is simply P implies Q, nothing but not P and Q. So it is in that sense you need to write like this. So now you have Hs here and not Hs here, and this branch closes. And now there is another path like this, Hs, not Ms, etc. and all, and then Ms here and not Ms here, and this also closes. So that means negation of this particular kind of thing leads to contradiction. So that means it has to be Ms rather than not Ms. So this is a proof which is based on something called as reductio ad absurdum kind of method. So this is that means the original conclusion is Ms rather than not Ms. So in this way we can guarantee that Socrates is mortal necessarily follows from all men are mortal and Socrates is man. So like this we can translate many formulas into the language of predicate logic. Then you can talk about the validity or the truth, the tautology of a given formula. Let us consider some more examples since we have sufficient time. So we can consider some more examples. Let us say a formula like this: for all x, px implies qx, and not qx. So this is closed by this particular kind of thing. So this is one particular kind of formula, and from this, whether or not you will be able to deduce this thing, there doesn't exist x such that px. So now we are trying to see whether this can be derived from this particular kind of thing or not. So in the semantic tableaux method, what you will do here is that you just take this as it is, and then you add the negation of the conclusion. So this is what you are trying to derive. That means this is a conclusion and all. So now what you will do in the second step is you negate this particular kind of thing and add to your sigma. So now you start constructing a tabla for this one, and then we'll see whether the tabla closes or not. Not of there exists some XPX, it is not of P. Whenever you come across a formula not P, you simply represent it as P only. So the same way you have this particular kind of thing. There exists some XPX. Not of there exists some XPX is simply this one. So how did we get this one? Two double negation. You need to give the justification to the right hand side. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense to talk about this particular kind of thing. We need to say how did we come to this particular kind of formula. So that's why we need to write justification on the right hand side, followed by this particular kind of formula. So now we need to talk about one instance of this particular kind of formula. So Px implies Qx and not Qx is true for all x and all. That means it has to be true for some kind of a also. So before that, there is one strategy that we need to follow. Always eliminate the existential quantifiers first. Rather than dealing with the universal quantifiers, first you handle with the existential quantifiers. Eliminate those existential quantifiers first and then move on to the universal quantifiers. So now there exists some xpx. If you come across this particular kind of thing, there exists some xpx. In the Tablux rule, we can replace it with pa, where this a should not occur anywhere else in the branch, which is above this particular kind of formula. Nowhere else that a has to exist. That means a has to be new. So now whenever you have a formula, there exists some xpx, you can simply represent it with pa. So now that is what we are trying to write. So now this is a Tablux rule. You can say existential instantiation or something like that. Now, so this px implies qx and not qx is true for any kind of a and all. That means it has to be true for a also. So that means it is pa implies qa and not qa. So now if you further expand this particular kind of thing, so this is one universal instantiation. So one instance of this one is this. So now this is going to be not PA and QA and not QA, you can write it as like this. Because P and Q can be simply written as PQ. It's like a trunk of your tree. Whenever you have P or Q, it is a branch PQ. So now you have PA here and not PA here. It closes and all. It is like cutting your own tree and all. You are sitting on a tree and you are cutting your own tree because there is a contradiction, PA and not PA. You cannot go further. So that's why it closes here. And already you have QA and not QA, it closes. So that means, so negation of this conclusion leads to the contradiction. That means the original conclusion holds. That is, what is the original thing which we have to deduce? That is, it is not the case that there exists some X, P, X. So that has to be true. So this is the way to show that this particular thing follows from the given formula Px implies Qx and not Qx. So now let us try to consider some one more example. Here what we will do is a given predicate logic sentence, we'll transform it into the language of predicate logic, and then we are trying to see whether that particular kind of formula, well-formed formula, is valid or not. So here is the statement which you come across in the natural language, and that is like this. So there is an object which is loved by every mathematician. So we don't know what kind of object it is. Let us assume that can be abstract object, it can be anything, which is allowed by every mathematician. This is for the sake of example, we take into consideration this thing. So therefore, every mathematician, loves at least one object, at least one this is abstract object, at least one abstract object. Mathematician doesn't require any real entities to exist in the world. They can even consider abstract object, and then they can still mathematics. They can still talk about the mathematics around surrounding that particular kind of abstract objects. So now here is an so it looks like that the conclusion seems to be following from the premises and all. We have to establish with the help of some kind of decision procedure method. So the first one states that there is an object, then there is an abstract object which is allowed by every mathematician, and then that implies, that means every mathematician allows at least one particular kind of abstract object should follow from, whether or not this follows from this or not is the one which we are trying to see. So now we need to translate these things into the language of predicate logic using the quantifiers. So the first one it can be translated in this sense. Suppose if X is considered to be an abstract object, abstract object is represented as AX, and for all Y, if X is a mathematician, then there is one more predicate that is there here, loved by every mathematician. So that means L Y X. That means for all the mathematicians, there is at least some kind of object X, and that mathematician, all the mathematicians, whatever is considered here mathematician, loves this X. So there is an order which we need to follow. Suppose if you write X and Y, that means X loves Y, and Y X means Y loves X. So there is an order that we follow in the predicate logic. So this is the translation of the first letter. So there is an object means there should be at least one object that should exist in all. That means there exists some X, and whatever is there here is the one which we have written. So now this is the formula which is represented by the premise, and then the conclusion is this thing. Every mathematician, that means you need to start with the quantifier for all Y. If Y is a mathematician, which is written in this sense, Y is a mathematician, that means there exists some X such that AX, that means X is an abstract object, and that mathematician has to love that particular kind of object X. So for all Y, if Y is a mathematician, then there exists some X such that X is an abstract object, and that X has to be loved by the mathematician, that means Y has to love X. So this is the conclusion. Once you represent it in terms of the language of predicate logic, then you don't have to worry about what is the content of this argument and all, and because we will be handling only the symbols that you see here. So now in the semantic tableaux method, as usual, we start with the negation of the conclusion. That means, so this is the first thing, there exists some X, and for all Y, MX implies LYX, etc. And then negation of the whole thing. Negation of for all Y, MY implies there exists some X, AX and LXY. So that means you are denying the whole formula. So now once you deny this, suppose if this conclusion indeed follows from the premises, then if you take the negation of the conclusion, then the branch should close and all. That means for example, if you take sigma into consideration, sigma as your premises, union not of alpha should lead to contradiction. So now this is the second one. now we need to use different rules, you know. So now our strategy is always this, that first you eliminate this existential quantifier. That means you need to find out an instance of this one. So now if you eliminate this existential quantifier, that means wherever you find x, you need to replace it with some kind of a parameter, a, b, c, whatever you feel like replacing it. So now the first one, existential instantiation, will become this. You take in, you replace x with a, and this becomes like this. For all y remains the same, mx, x is replaced by a, and then l, y remains the same, and then x is replaced by a. So this is what is existential instantiation of one existential instantiation. One instance of this one is this. So now next time when you remove this existential quantifier, you should ensure that you are not using this particular kind of thing, parameter a. So you have to use another different kind of parameter. So now this can be represented as this thing. So this is, for example, if you have a formula x and y, in the tree you can simply write x and y. It's like a trunk and all. So that means three simplification, or it's a conjunction rule, so it will be like this. For all y, m a implies l y e. So this is the fifth step. So now we have this particular kind of formula. We need to simplify this one. Then, so this will become like this. So it is not for all y, my implies there exists some x. So we have this particular kind of formula. Not for all y, x, if that is there like this, then it will become there exists some x, not x. So in the same way, it is like not for all y, that means there exists some y, and then you push this negation inside, and then this will become the entire thing, my, whatever is there, yeah, my implies there exists some x, ax, and this formula lxy. So now this is coming like this. So this is considered as the sixth step. So this is a simplification of this particular kind of thing. Now, one instance of this particular kind of thing is like this. Just getting out. So now this formula can be written in this sense. If you replace y with this thing, it will become b. You are not supposed to use a here. It will become b. So now this is same. There exists some x, ax, and lx, and then he replaced y with b. So this is one instance of 6. So now 8, we have mb. So this is double negation of 7. Implication, negation and implication will become this thing. Negation of this particular kind of thing is like this. Negation of p implies q is nothing but p and not q. So this is first one is mb, and the second one is not of there exists some x, ax, and lx b. So this is a simplification, and then not of for all x this one will become negation of existential quantifier will become for all x not of ax and lx. So now one instance of this one, because it happens for all x and all, it has to be true for this one also. So that means not of a and not of l a b. So this has to be true for all kinds of anything which you take into consideration for x, it has to be true. That means for a also it has to be true and all. In that sense we have written like this, 10 and universal instantiation. So now we are getting closer to our proof. The 12th one is MBLBA. That has come from this one. MALYA. It happens for all the thing and all. 5th one, MY. MYLYA is getting over there. So now 13th step, if you expand it and all, this will become not MB and LBA, and then this branch closes because not MB is here and MB is here, and then this branch it can be further expanded to not AA and then not LBA. So this and this closes and all. So ultimately what has happened is, if you take the formula, if you take this as premise and this is a conclusion, if you negate the conclusion, it leads to closure of all the branches and all. So with this we will end this lecture and all. So what we discuss in this lecture is simply is that we discussed about semantic tableaux method, which serves as some kind of decision procedure method with which you can we can find out whether or not a given well-formed formula is valid. We did not talk about the consistency, satisfiability, etc. and all. More or less, you know, in the case of consistency, if you are given two sentences in the predicate logic and you construct a tree using the same kind of rules and all, if at least one branch is open and that is considered to be, these two formulas are considered to be consistent. So in the next lecture we will be talking about some more examples so that we get familiarize ourselves with this particular kind of method.